Thank you for coming here today. On behalf of the family, we want to welcome you to the celebration of life of Ray Payne Burroughs. Her life here on earth has ended, but her life is continuing in heaven. So we are celebrating the gift that she has been here on earth and celebrating that she has continuous life now. If you'll notice, towards the top of your program, it says, Ray of Sunshine for the Lord. And that is an appropriate moniker for her, along with the passage from Ezra 7, and it speaks of how good the hand of God was with Ezra, because Ezra had set his heart to study the law of the Lord, both to do it and to teach it, and that really was Ray. The hand of the Lord was on Ray's life, and it was evidently on Ray's life. If you ever encountered her, she had the smile, the joy of the Lord radiating from her, and she had set her heart to understand God's word and to teach it to others and made it her life mission. And it's obvious that God's good hand was on Ray. Today we're going to have a chance to hear in just a moment Ray's favorite scripture read. We're going to hear the reason for hope that Ray had and now enjoys, and then we're going to rejoice hearing this promise of Psalm 23 as it's sung, and hear reflections about Ray from her family. And then after a time of the family sharing before we close, we're going to welcome anyone who would like to share how Ray affected you. We'd like you to come up and share, hey, here's how positively she affected me, or maybe just a little anecdote or a humorous story, something to encourage and edify the family, to comfort them, to remember her, to honor her, and to honor her God, who Ray lived clearly to honor in every way. Her life's purpose is in your bulletin as well, and it could really be summed up if you look at towards the end of that. It's to live for God's glory and for his pleasure. Ray truly did live for God's glory and his pleasure, so it's only fitting that we would have this service bring glory to God now at the end of her earthly life. So let's pray together that God's blessing would be on this time, that he would comfort all of us who mourn. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to begin by thanking you for the gift of life that Ray was to each and every person here. God, we're grateful for her. We're grateful for how she modeled kindness. She modeled joy. She modeled strength of character and hope in you. God, we ask that you would comfort her family as they mourn for her loss. Would you give us grace to live by the example that she gave to us, a life lived for your pleasure, for your glory, God, and in the midst of sorrow, would you give your everlasting hope and the joy that she had and now experiences in you. God, thank you for her. Thank you that we can mourn with hope. Hope that she is with you. Father, comfort all of us by your grace. Give us your peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, in just a moment, we're going to hear Ray's favorite scripture. Gwen, if you'll go ahead and come up. And then followed by that is a slideshow of some of the moments celebrating Ray's life. Gwen, if you'll read to us from Psalm 16. Thank you.
Forevermore.
I wanted to tell you how closely I've kept the memories of you in my heart, and all of the lifetimes that we've had to share, live even though we're apart. But don't cry for me, 'cause I'm finally free. To run with the angels on streets made of gold, to listen to stories of saints new and old, to worship our Maker. That's where I'll be when you finally find me.
Asked for me to share with you a little bit about Ray, and I've called this time a message of hope, because as we were talking about Ray and thinking about her life, it was really characterized by that one word. It was really characterized by her hope. Characterized by her hope in God, her hope in the Lord. She had hope in Jesus that Titus tells us, that Paul told us about in Titus. He says, but when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Christ Jesus our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. That was Ray's hope. That is Ray's realized hope right now. She knew the goodness and the loving kindness of God as her Savior, and she was so filled with hope that she kind of exuded it through her smile. If you ever encountered her, she was always smiling. No matter what the circumstance, no matter what the situation, she always had a bright, beaming smile, and it drew people to her. I was talking to Judy, and she was like, even when her mind had gone in her old age, she would go in the grocery store, and her smile would draw people there, so much so that she had strangers come up to and kiss her on the cheek and just say, thank you for being so joyful. Thank you for your example. you couldn't help but be attracted to the kindness and goodness and joy of the Lord in her that she shone forth. It was genuine, though. It was a genuine joy, and she set people at ease, and Jesus shone through her smile. Her hope defined her. It was her hope that in Jesus that gave her joy. It was her hope that motivated how she sought to live. It's what sustained her through life and dementia and sickness to the end. I loved hearing the story about how when Ray was 12 years old, she went to a church revival service, and she heard a message from Jeremiah 18:6 about the potter and the clay, and she discovered that God is the potter, the maker, and the one who created us, the one who gave us life, and that we are his clay. And then from that moment on, that defined how she viewed herself. She viewed herself as God's instrument to be used by him, for him, in submission to his will. She knew that when we live life resisting God's good designs for us, it's like the clay rebelling against the potter and pushing back or jumping off the wheel, and it doesn't end well for the clay. And so instead, she submitted her life to Jesus, and she spent her life being molded into the image of God, being used for his purposes. And Judy was telling me she used to keep clay pots all over her house of different shapes and sizes to remind her really of whose she was, and that God is a good potter. She discovered that hope is found not in following her own selfish purposes or in self-fulfillment or what we can achieve or earn, but in trusting in Jesus, and she did that fully. She lived a life fully dependent on, fully trusting in Jesus. She had this overwhelming joy that would set you at ease. She had this sense of peace and calm that came from knowing that all of her sins were forgiven, that the greatest problem in her life was already taken care of, and so she was at peace and she was at rest in all of her moments. She knew that she was saved by God's grace, not by her own works. And she found hope knowing that Jesus lived his life for her. And her joy came from knowing that when she trusted in Jesus, God gave her all the merits of his own son, Jesus. And I love that in her purpose statement, if you can read that in your bulletin, it says that she wanted to live as his masterpiece, his treasure, because she really understood that she had all of the merit of Jesus by trusting in him. And so now she truly was his masterpiece, truly was his treasure. What an inspirational way to live, knowing that we are treasured by Jesus, knowing that we are his masterpiece. The more she matured, the more being a disciple of Jesus became her identity, and her hope was secure, knowing that God was making her more and more like Jesus. Even with her dementia, she was able to be a witness and a light. The day before she died, the last picture you saw on the slideshow was she got to visit downtown Greenville with her healthcare provider and took picture of her beside a sign. And that sign, it was Psalm 139:14. It says, "I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well." What an amazing last picture to have. What an amazing testimony. That really describes her life. She praised Jesus with her life. She was fearfully and wonderfully made. And she also testified of God's wondrous works, and her soul knew it very well. She not only knew that she was fearfully and wonderfully made, she saw everyone else that way too, and she knew that God's truth would affect people. God's truth would change and transform lives. It's what motivated her. The truth of God's word is what motivated her. She went to Olivet Nazarene College. It sustained her. God's grace sustained her through 53 years of marriage. She was a wonderful wife who honored her husband in big ways and small. And when he had dementia himself, Judy was saying she would always make fresh iced tea for him and put money in his pocket for every day and make sure there was fresh fruit, and she'd light a fire in the fireplace and care for him and when he was unable to care for himself. And that really just spoke to her character. Whether he knew it or not, she continued to care. And her hope of knowing God, it motivated her to go back to school. After she retired in Florida, He went back to school, graduated from Gulf Shore Seminary with a major in biblical counseling, and then she continued her studies in the Institute of Biblical Counseling. And then after that, so this is in her retirement, by the way. I want to be like her when I retire. And in her retirement, she then started Hope Biblical Counseling Center, and it remains to this day, affecting thousands of people. And she started that counseling ministry, named it Hope, which I think is a fitting description for her life. But she named it that because it spelled out helping others for the purpose of eternity. And that really was what she made her life all about. She made her life about helping others for the purpose of eternity. And she lived with this hope of the eternal purpose in her mind. And it motivated her to missions as well. And she always had missionaries staying in her home. And she had those in need. And she was the missions chairman in her church. And she was always participating in some kind of outreach. And she had a heart for the homeless. No one left her presence without feeling like she deeply loved them. And they were deeply loved. I don't know anybody who didn't enjoy being around Ray. If she were here and able to speak to you today, I'm confident that she would have a big, warm, genuine, kind, loving smile on her face. She would share with you that she wants all of us, everyone here, to know the same hope that she has. Hope that is now realized for her. And if you don't know Jesus personally, I know that she would want you to know that true hope is found through repenting and turning to Him. If you've wandered from God, Ray would want you to come back to Him. God stands ready to embrace you with open arms. And if you do know Him, she would encourage you to not give up, to continue to be a disciple who grows in God and makes disciples. And she would give you a smile and tell you that she wants you to know the peace and the joy, the hope of God through knowing Him as your shepherd. And now, if I could ask the band to go ahead and come up, we're going to hear Psalm 23 in song, along with a prayer that expresses really the same hope that Ray has. Psalm 23 talks about the Lord being our great shepherd.
Thank you.
His endless mercy has followed her, and his truth has led her home. And our hope is that Ray is home with Jesus right now. We have great confidence and hope in that. At this time, we want to invite the family to go ahead and come up, and we'll start with Bob Burrows. If you would go ahead and come up, that would be excellent, of Ray Burrows, and followed by Jim, and then we'll have Tiffany and Chris, and then we'll end with Roger and Judy. And then after that, we'll open it up to a time to share. So if Mr. Burrows, if you'll share, that'd be great. Thank you.
It's great to be here this morning. This time of should be a time of rejoicing. Ray and my father were married 51 years ago, long time. Right before my loving wife Susan and I were married. So I have some experience with decades-long marriage. It takes a great deal of love to have that sustained. It's a love that brings a happy and joyous time, a joyous marriage together, a love which can only come from God, a love which is patient and kind, a love which keeps no record of wrongs, as Paul teaches us in 1 Corinthians 13. And Ray certainly expressed that love that she was given in many, many ways. As was mentioned, she was in a ministry of Jews for Jesus in Cleveland at the chapel in Beechwood. And she also was in an euthetic counselor, that's a biblical truth counselor, in Fort Myers, and certainly spread her love throughout her house in Fort Myers. There's scriptures on the walls, and which benefited all who came into contact with her. She certainly impacted people through her marriage, through her children, and through the relationship she had. And she is now simply in a different part of a sequence, of God's sequence, a sequence that has started a long time ago. And about that sequence, in Genesis 1:1, we are told about in the beginning, or better, in the creation phase of God's sequence, when God created the heavens and the earth. The first 11 chapters of Genesis are actually a history, and are put in history so that we can understand the setting that God set us in our cosmic existence and our uniqueness. And we can then learn from these truths. In the Jewish mind, as we learn throughout the Bible, truth is a truth which is founded in history. It's not a temporary situational thing like modern truth, where we worry about PC and those other worthless kinds of values. This is a truth that's an abundant truth that lasts forever. But we know that it's in a sequence before, in the beginning, many things happened. That is, before, in the beginning, which is a difficult kind of a concept. But before, in the beginning, we learn that there was a triune God, that this God expressed love, God's love. In John 17:24, Jesus said, Thou loved me before the foundations of the earth were laid. In Ephesians 1, we learn that we were chosen individually before the foundations of the earth. There were relationships. In Isaiah 6:8, who shall we send? We, it wasn't just a static existence. It was an existence that had had communication, had promises and plans were laid, and love existed. Intrinsic parts of our existence. In the step along the way, in John 1, we learn that in the beginning was the Word. The proper translation is, in the beginning already was the Word. Not just a static thing, but already there. Already the Word was with God, and already the Word was God. The Word which already was created and is now and will be. A full description of these thoughts could be found in Francis Schaeffer's book, The Genesis in Space and Time. The sequence continues. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul states, now we see through a glass darkly, then face to face. What a wonderful place to be, a place where Ray is now, face to face with our Savior.
Anyways, what do you say about a mother that gave you eternal life? She's the one that brought Jesus to our family. Anything that you might say would be an understatement. But here it goes. I talked to these three prominent theologians, and I was going to go through that, what they said, and a little bit about from a family perspective. And then close with this song that actually Jesus sent us that we could all listen to. So I had this pleasure of contacting theologians. The first one was Alistair Begg. He's now a nationally syndicated radio preacher. He preaches on Moody Radio and literally hundreds of radio stations across the country. His program is called Truth for Life. And Grandma and my dad helped Alistair found their original church, his original church in Cleveland, Parkside Church. Now it's a very big church. And Alistair liked to come down to Fort Myers and play golf with my father, stay at Ray's house. I think one reason why he liked to come down there because the name of the golf course was Fiddlesticks, and it kind of reminded him of his home in England, Fiddlesticks. And Dad made him play golf at literally the name of this course is the Long Mean. It was the longest golf course you ever saw, and it was so mean. It had sand and water everywhere. Literally, my son and I, we would go out and buy a dozen golf balls every time each, dozen golf balls each, every time we played the Long Mean. But some reason, Alistair came and liked to play that course. And here's what Alistair said. Alistair's wife's name is Susan. And he said, Susan and I have warm memories of Ray, and like many, we have benefited from her prayerful encouragement. So now we have a nationally recognized preacher where we're supposed to draw our encouragement from. He's getting his encouragement from Ray Burroughs. So I think encouragement is a highlight of Grandma's life. And then Alistair goes on to say that Ray is like Anna in Luke 2, 36 through 38. Ray and Anna gave thanks to God and spoke about Jesus to all that would listen, about eternal life through Jesus. In the passage that Alistair sent us, Jesus is a baby, and he's with Mary and Joseph. He's being dedicated in the temple. And two people are mentioned. Simeon is mentioned, and Simeon is the person that he couldn't die until he saw the Messiah. And so he looked upon Jesus, he said, "This is the Messiah." In different words, but this is the Messiah. And then Anna was there also, and that's who Alistair compared Grandma to, Anna. Anna praised God and spoke to anyone and everyone about Jesus and the pathway to eternal life. So those were Alistair's comments. Then the two other theologians are that helped Grandma continue her work at Hope Counseling Center. Dr. Virginia Stewart, the past director. Grandma actually passed the Hope Counseling on to Virginia. And the basic concept of Hope Counseling was biblical counseling. The Bible has all the guidance, all the lessons that we need in order to help us enjoy our everyday life. So not only do we have to wait until we pass over, but we can enjoy our life today. And so she would counsel people on how to use the Bible and enjoy your life today. And again, Virginia used the words encouragement. Grandma was an encouragement to all of us at Hope Counseling Center. Because of her work, she goes on to say, many came to Christ. Yeah, and HOPE is the acronym that came to Grandma in a dream. God told her to call it HOPE, helping others for purposes of eternity. And third, from a family perspective, her one life, just in our family, brought over 40 people to Christ. You can see the generations. So the children, the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, the generations. I mean, just in our family, 40 people. One became 40. What kind of a gift she gave to our family. I want to amplify one aspect that Grandma knew and part of her Hope Counseling ministry. She knew that Jesus died that we would have an abundant life. John 10:10. And our mentor said that her life is used in that passage, John 10:10. It was used, the Greek word is Zoe. And Zoe is God's life. So imagine God's life. Anything you want, anything you need, you have. But Jesus died, this passage says, Jesus died to give us that abundant life. And our struggles and the struggles of all these people that she counseled are not of flesh and blood. They're not your spouse. The struggle is not your spouse. It's not your coworker. It's not your boss. These struggles are actually from the devil, from the evil, supernatural evil force. We have to battle against those struggles in our mind in order to enjoy our everyday life. So here's how we repay her, somebody that gave you eternal life. The way we repay her is to love and encourage others always. Live a life that pleases God. So encouragement, number one. Turn our eyes to Jesus. Feel his presence daily. And acknowledge his hand in our life. Have your heart open enough to acknowledge his hand in your life and acknowledge his what he does for us, his God winks. I call him God winks. And hope. Help others for the purpose of eternity. Pass it on to others. So, my wife Wanda and I, we feel like God speaks to us in with music, sometimes sermons, different, all kinds of different things. And when we heard that Grandma went into hospice, Jesus sent us this song that I want to play. Turn Your Eyes, it's an old song, but it's a new rendition of it. Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. So what I was thinking in my mind, that as she goes into hospice, turn her eyes upon, she was turning her eyes more and more toward Jesus and letting the old world fade away. Let the old world fade away. This is what she wanted for herself. For years and years, she wanted to see Jesus' face to face. And that's what she wants for all of us. To see, get closer and closer to Jesus day by day. So if that baby's still on, I'm going to play this song. And then the last verse, if she's going to sing one verse, but if you could, wouldn't mind joining in, you can sing the other verse. I think you may know the words. I know Roger does. Roger used to sing this when we went to Holden Beach. So.
I love how my uncles are so technologically savvy, and I've got pancake battered paper up here. My grandma is the treasure of my heart. Sorry. She worked so hard to get to others and be an example of Christ's love in everyday matters. She is a hero to me and a testament of the love of God She inspired me at a very young age to go into counseling. I went to an aesthetic counseling conference with her and my teens and quickly realized that the wisdom in counseling required life experience and a strong prayer life, neither of which I had developed yet. But the memories of her confidence in my abilities and pride in my desire to try to help others stuck with me throughout my life journey. Grandma graduated with her master's degree in counseling when I was 15-ish. I went to her graduation, and her tenacity for learning and earning that diploma later in life inspired me to persevere through my undergraduate and graduate studies. I can see her telling me to keep learning and loving God and helping others. Even now, though I didn't go into adult counseling, I counseled children every day through my elementary teaching position. She was instrumental in my love for others. Grandma helped me to see that God's gifts were ordinary people and ordinary moments. Each of them is special and should be treasured. Being the oldest grandchild in the Easton family, I have the treasure of those early Ohio years. We lived close to Grandma and would visit her often. She would make forts out of tables and sneak candy and Jell-O to me when Mom wasn't looking. She would snuggle her dog Toy Lee into my pillows and tell me to be cozy. I went on adventures in her boat and slept on pillows under the bow while she would make eggs for me in the morning in the little kitchen on the boat. I'm sure there's a name for that, I just can't remember. When I close my eyes and picture heaven, I think of Grandma's flower garden in Ohio. I find my peaceful sanctuary there. I'm so sorry. She made her home into a child's wonderland in so many ways without even knowing it. Thanks. I have the prayer garden where she regularly placed hand-painted rocks. Smooth as silk and colorfully scriptured into a nest of other rocks, stepping stones and evergreen trees painted the background. As you gaze down from the trees, you'd see a field of daffodils in a little log cabin. I have a vivid memory of running through those flowers towards my mom and collapsing in those flowers, laughing as Grandma brought lemonade onto the back porch. She'd whisper to me when no one was looking, "I love you forever." My mom and I played hide and seek in those daffodils and laughed together while I was probably still wearing diapers. I had many tea parties with Grandma and Papa squeezed into the little log cabin in their backyard. She would make Papa fold himself into that tiny toy cabin in the backyard so I could have a proper guest for my tea party. She also made my cousins do that too. Papa did those sorts of things for his wife because he loved her. Grandma made forts under her fancy tables when I wasn't feeling well or just because she could. She pulled out Mom's old dolls for me and let me dress up her dog in the doll's outfits, despite protests from the dog. Grandma introduced me to the ocean, finding seashells, watching the sunset over the ocean, panpiper music, boats, and fancy outfits. Even if you were wearing wool and you were visiting the beach in Florida, it didn't matter if you were itchy and wearing tights in the sand. Everything she did was truly magical. While Grandma was lost in grief over the loss of her husband, she succumbed to solitude. Grandma was a lover of people and God. She continued her gift of grief counseling. While she continued to give her love to others, she became isolated in her daily life. What a joy it was to see her come to her new home, at her daughter and son's house. She had been worn down by isolation, but she found respite in being surrounded by great-grandchildren, family, and church family. She is well-loved by all of us. She is happy in reuniting with those who have passed before you and me in heaven. Most of all, she must remember us now. She must be so joyful to know that the shimmer she felt while she couldn't remember the words was the love of our beautiful Jesus. In his arms, she must be singing the song she sang to me as a child. God's not dead, he is alive. God's not dead, he is alive. God's not dead, he is alive. Alive, I feel him all over me. She is opening her arms and saying to us all, I love you. The best is yet to come.
My grandmother Ray was an amazing person. My grandmother's love for Christ shaped my life and the life of my family. Her joy was infectious, and even when I was down, she brought me joy. She poured out her life for everyone around her, as many of you know. One funny memory I have of my grandmother was when I was 7, I flew down to visit her, and she had heard that I liked dinosaurs. She heard there was a dinosaur movie playing, so she took me and my cousin Chris to see Jurassic Park at the age of 7. Needless to say, it left quite an impression, and it led to my love for dinosaurs as a child and many sleepless nights for myself and my parents. Throughout my life, she was such a great example of how we should pursue Christ. My grandmother was always looking to build our family up through everything. She was one of the most selfless people I have ever met. When our family was in crisis or she saw an area of need, she would come alongside us and give everything she had to help. She helped shape the love that I have for the Jewish people, and I'll always treasure those moments that we had together. I am so thankful that my children and my wife got to know my grandmother and be a part of her life. I will miss having her humor and her smiles at our family events. God blessed our family with a woman who knew what Christ wanted her to be. She was always pointing us to the cross and sharing the love of our Savior with everyone around her. Ray Burroughs leaves a legacy of love and always putting Christ's will first in our lives. We'll miss you, Grandma.
This is not good to come off a crying session and have to talk about my mother. Well, I remember back when Judy and I first got married. Papa, Ray's husband, had helped me get a job at GE, and I was in a research lab. And I thought I'd arrived. I was making a whopping $12,500 a year, and thought we had arrived. Of course, that didn't get us very far. Papa and Mom employed me on weekends to help our income situation. And that started a legacy with my my mother-in-law's involvement in our lives. Back about 25 years ago, I I made some really poor decisions for the family, and it led to some crises in our life. And Mom should have been very angry at me for the decisions I made. Of course, she was upset. But quickly she came alongside of me. And in her Ray-ish way, and helped me center my life back on the gospel again. And it really saved our marriage. So, when Jameson and I went down to check on Mom about 4 years ago, because there were some things going on that weren't, Mom was really struggling, and her son Jim had, and Nick, her grandson Nick, had done a great job just checking in on her, making sure she was okay, but there were some other things going on with Mom. And Judy had had to go down there several times that year, and we realized we needed to do something in addition to what was already going on. It was an easy job to decide to bring her back and live with us. I'm certainly not saying that's what everybody should do, but for us, it was a easy decision. And as Mom began to decline mentally, I had to resist temptations of remembering that, because that's the way my own mother went. And my own mother had gotten to the point where the last time I visited her, I walked into the room and she was terrified of me. Thankfully, my mother-in-law was never. I think everybody can appreciate the fact that my mother-in-law always had a smile. And I can't think of anybody who is here in this room that wouldn't agree with me that my mother-in-law, if you were to, and I think one of the, Bob or Jim Munn said it, if you were going to think of my mother-in-law, you would think of her as somebody who smiled. Even when her mind was going, Judy and I would talk and we'd say, evidences of the Holy Spirit in her life. And Mom would smile. And I'd say, though there's not as much left in there as there used to be, Jesus is working through her. And she'd smile. The grandsons said, you probably saw one of the pictures here. Oliver, I think it was, crawled into bed next to her with his popcorn, because Oliver loves popcorn, and just ate it next to her. Emerson would crawl into bed with her and jump on her bed and have a good time, and Mom smiled. Didn't understand necessarily everything that was going on, but she smiled. I had prayed, and Judy had prayed, that when her time came to go, that she would go quickly. So when one of our nursing assistants had come to check on Mom Saturday morning and called me in there because something wasn't right, it took one look at her face to know that she'd gone. And so there was a mixture of joy. I'd expressed to Kimberly one time when we were together that one of my problems with having Mom live with us, problems, was that my feet were in two different places. One was, Jesus, just don't let her go on this way. This is so hard to see the woman that was talked about this morning, truly was talked about this morning, see her gone in that sense. And then there was my other foot planted that said, no, Jesus, don't take her. Because I'd miss her too much. And though I was not her physical son, she was mom to me for a long time. She was my mom. Now, mom's with Jesus. And as has been talked about, Bob put it well theologically, and Jim put another spin on it, but she's with Christ, and she's enjoying his presence right now. But I'm here to tell you, yes. And I will till I'm called out. Hopefully you can appreciate that strong woman, the weak though she was in the flesh, had through love and encouragement woven herself into our hearts like very few people in this life ever could. And that's why I'll miss her until I'm called home to glory. So, if you see either one of us break down, it's not because we're not happy for Mom. We are. But Doc, there's no replacement for her. Now, she left me a wonderful image of her in my wife. So when I see my dear bride, I see my mother-in-law, and I'm thankful for that. So, as we turn our eyes upon Jesus, thank you, Jim, for playing that. As we turn our eyes upon Jesus, and we look full in his wonderful face, and we are so grateful for all that he's done for us. I really want everybody to remember my mom's smile. And remember that even in her mental condition, that she was still made in his image. And Christ had been formed in her through her lifetime. And as those two came together, they expressed themselves in a wonderful smile. I miss her, and I love her. And I'm glad she's with Jesus. All of those things together. I would be remiss if I didn't say thank you, church family, for all that you've done. Thank you, Synergy and the CNAs that helped out Mom for all that they did. And we've got several of them here this morning. I see you. Thank you to our family that's here this morning and through grief was able to articulate very well your love for Mom. Thank you to my dear bride, who was a wonderful daughter and is a wonderful daughter to her mom. As I remember those days when she would painstakingly prepare breakfast for Mom and try to give her a variety of things every morning, And even when she got to the point when physically it was too hard for her to help mom get into bed at night, and so we called on Synergy and the wonderful CNAs to help us out. She'd still go in there and pray with her. Loved her to the end. To when mom had passed, seeing my dear bride just bury her face in the mom's hair, because she loved mom's hair. And it was one of the sweetest expressions that she could have in showing her love for her mama. All of a bunch of other stories that I could bore you to tears with. All that to say, as my daughter said, well, it was in the many of the mundane moments that she showed so many things to us of Christ's love. And we're grateful for that. So the memories we have are wonderful memories of a woman who loved Jesus passionately. And even into the end, when her dementia took over, she was no longer able to express in words what was in her heart. Still, we had her smile. I just want to thank you all for coming here and being a part, because I know each and every one of you have had a part of mom's life and grandma's life, great-grandma's life, friends. Just grateful for all of you, and she would be too. She will be grateful to see the extension of her family represented in all of you here. So thank you for being a part of that.
How good and appropriate it is that, Roger, that you and all of us would miss Ray. It's good and appropriate. She is and has been such a huge gift to her family and to everyone who knew her. And it's good to miss the gifts that God has given to us when they are taken from us. And it's meant to have us do a few things in response. One, it should provoke us. Say, I want to be a gift like that. I want to be a gift like Ray. But in order to be a gift like Ray, you have to know the hope that Ray knows. And so if you don't, we should provoke in us, we want to know the hope that Ray knows. And we want that hope to so infect us that we shine the light of Jesus, the love of Jesus to other people as well. And I don't know about you, but I'm provoked to want to be more like Ray. If one day I could be like Ray, what a wonderful work God will have done in my life. Because God did a wonderful work in her life. And she is a testimony to the grace of God at work in a life transformed by his grace. May we all live that way in response to his grace. We're going to take a moment and open it up. If anybody would like to share, I'm going to have this mic right here for just a couple moments. So would anybody like to share? Just go and put your hands up so we can see if there's any interest in sharing anything about Ray. Okay, excellent. Go ahead and come on up then. And as soon as you see somebody else start to end, you can go ahead and come up, or you can just form a line over here, actually. It'd be great. Just if you wouldn't mind, Mary and Robin, if you wouldn't mind just standing over there, start a line, that would be great. And then whoever else wants to share, if you will get in line too, that would be wonderful. The more, the better. Even if you just have a story about what she said or how she affected you or her smile, that it would be a wonderful encouragement to the family. Thank you.
Okay. I think it's a glorious thing at a homecoming to see all the children rise up and call her blessed. That's something that all of us strive for, I know, as mothers. So I'm really happy to see that. And I never knew the Ray here. She might have intimidated me a little bit. She's so accomplished and everything. So I think what Tiffany said was right. When I met her, she was already looking towards home. And for me, didn't have to have feet in two sides like you did, Roger. For me, it was easy. I got the fun stuff because she was a hoot. I enjoyed her thoroughly. She was always ready to dance when the music was playing, even though we were in church and we probably shouldn't have been doing that. And we always told each other how beautiful and wonderful we were. especially when we wore blue, which is why we're wearing blue today. I see that Gwen is as well. And I just got a kick out of her. And I had recently gone through dementia with my mom too, which was, like you, Roger, a vastly different journey. And Ray, what she taught me, and I think she taught a lot of us facing this journey right now, is that it's okay, that Jesus is with you. No matter what comes, Jesus is with you. And that what she believed was really true. You could see that. This is not a fake thing. This was reality. Jesus Christ lived inside of Ray Burroughs. And you could see it. And for me, it's like you said, Matt, I'm encouraged to be joyful. You know, we also have that spirit in us. And she taught me to be joyful in spite of it all. And she always loved everybody. The last time I saw her, really, we watched 2 hours of football together, which was kind of weird since I'm not a football fan at all, and neither one of us really knew what's going on. But we had fun. and she always just hugged you when you left and said, I love you. And you're so beautiful. That's what she always said to you. You're so beautiful. And I love you. So I was really glad to meet her. She has changed my life dramatically. Yeah, in how she has approached homecoming with Christ. And for all of us people who are older than I'm going to say, that's a gift. And she taught till the end and comforted till the end. So I was blessed to know her.
If you spent any time with Mama, as we all called her Mama, over the past few years, you would know that you were very special and that you were wonderful, because she always told everybody that. And she made you feel that in a just very special and wonderful way. And I'll just share a brief little story that always makes me smile when I remember it. A group of us were kind of standing over there one day celebrating something, and I don't even remember what it was, and Judy did this wonderful little Judy dance that she does, and I said, that's how she got 8 children. And her mama just started laughing. She said, that's right. And it was just this precious little this little moment that we had that I just always enjoyed spending time with her and having that sweet Ray hug every time we had church. And I'm just going to miss her very much, and I'm just so thankful for all of you for sharing her with us for the years that we had her here, because I do see her in you, and I see her in all of you as well. And I'm just very, very thankful for that, and I want you all to see her in me and all of us as well.
Couple things I noticed in the things that you all shared is that I feel in her too is her smile, her encouragement. I see her legacy and the ordinary moments, and that's what I want to share with you. I don't know what to do about that. Closer. Oh dear, that's not in my. Okay. So, and this is an ordinary moment. I want to share with you that's touched my life and something that I will carry with me. We live in a world that tells us that the elderly and the sick cannot share God's love. And that's not true. I didn't know her until after she was sick. And she would come, when she first moved here, she would come, we greet. And so I'd be at the door standing there with my children. She would walk in every Sunday with her smile, say, are these your children? They're so lovely. And that was Christ's love for me. And she shared that in her illness. And so I want to share that with you. And I want the world to know how God can use people at any stage of life. And then the other thing has struck me as I'm here today, the first thing I said when I found out she passed is I want my children to be there. They're 6 and 8, and I look around, and there's a couple other children their ages here. And for me, I said, I want my children to see a legacy of a life well lived and the legacy that she leaves. She leaves that in you guys and your children, and I know you feel that, but I also want you to know that's in the children of our congregation too, and that lives on through them also. So I wanted to share that with you. So y'all are in our prayers. We're all going to miss her smile, but we're all going to carry it in our hearts.
I want to say that I met Ray because I worked for Synergy, and I would go with her, go there and spend the weekends and help her, or the days and help her. But my first day of meeting her, she said, when I introduced myself, and my name's Ray, and I got just a sense of relief, of like a lift of like God's hands. I can't even explain it. That she was like a ray of sunshine. Her smile just lit up the room. No matter what my week was going on through the day or anything was going on in my life, just seeing her when I walked through that door and said, good morning, Ray. It's my ray of sunshine, and I love you. And she'd look at me with a beautiful, amazing smile and just say, I love you too. I remember one day we were watching TV, and I was trying to get her to play with a puzzle with me, and she said no, she wanted to watch TV. She just looked over at my face, and she just gave me this smile like an angel. I don't even, just it was just a smile that just lit up the room, and she just touched my face, and she said, I love you. And a job is, you're supposed to be the person that gives out to the person that you're taking care of. But in this case, your mom was like was a gift to us. Me and my daughter, it was a blessing to be the ones that take care of her. And I thank you so much for sharing your mom, your grandmother with us. And we would truly miss her. You're all in our prayers and our thoughts.
I just want to give God the glory for the gift that he's given us to this church family and having Ray with us for these last couple of years. I don't think that Roger and Judy had any idea when they brought her here. And we had all been praying for some time that she would come. We didn't know what we were praying for, did we? Because what a gift. What a gift. And I just want to also publicly commend Roger and Judy for the way that they laid their lives down. They have laid down their lives for the last few years. And they have put God's love for us, his dying, giving love for us, on display. And they have adorned the gospel of Christ in their just boundless pouring out. And the Lord strengthened them. That's one of the things too that I've seen in the last couple of years, how the Lord just gave them grace upon grace, strength upon strength, because what they've done in their flesh could not have been done just in their flesh. It's not been easy. But I just want to thank you for the gift that you brought to all of us by bringing Ray here. What a gift. Everyone's already said the rest of the things that are on my heart. We have all been beautifully provoked by Ray's life and her joy and her love for the Savior. And it's the cry of my heart that I would age like Ray Burroughs. but really, I just thank you to the Easton family, like everyone said. for the way you've loved her and for the way you have shared her with us. Thanks.
This can be very short because I got other mic time. We got to, I think we're going to watch a video of Ray singing in a minute. And Judy had sent that to me earlier in the week. And so we've done a lot of singing at my house this week. But I played that video that you're going to all see for my kids over and over again this morning. Well, I was just going to do it once, but they wanted it over and over again. So, in the video, it's Judy and it's Ray, and they are singing Trust and Obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. And I had Junie and Ezra, Junie's almost five, Ezra's almost three, there. Junie was just remembering Ray and remembering hugs and remembering being special. So just thinking about legacy and just the sweetness of that being the echo and the song. And Ezra at the end, again, just with the legacy, over and over, he'd smile over, good morning, because that was the end, good morning. And he'd smile, and I wanted to video them and show them and have them watch the video at the same time, and you know, have that complicated moment on your phone where you're like, oh no, I can't do that. this is all in the same place. But he goes, can we go to her house today? And that was just such a precious moment because, again, legacy of getting to share. We can't go to that house, maybe today, and that would be okay. Yes, we get to go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's talk about that. Let's have that hope of eternity. Always, always upon these, our hearts and these hearts. And so, again, I had mic time and I wasn't going to share, but let's go. Let's go. Let's go to Ray's house.
Well, would anybody else like to share? Excellent, thank you.
I think I just want to reiterate the ordinary and just how she just gave herself and showed God's love in ordinary events and ordinary smiles and ordinary parts of the day, and how we think we remember so much, but we forget so much of that little thing, the little moments of God being in our lives all the time. She never forgot that. And there was a time, a couple months ago when she was in very poor health, and we almost thought we were saying goodbye to her. And I was sitting with her alone, and she started coughing really bad, and I started getting worried, like, the nurse left to go get Judy. She turned to me and she had this huge smile on her face and she said, hairball, and just started laughing. And I knew then that it wasn't going to be Ray's time. So she was able to stay with us and share more of her love. Thank you.
There's a lot of things I'd like to say right now. And I could write a speech that could go on for hours about her life and how she's touched my life, my life with my wife, and how she counseled us as a couple before we were married, and then also as we had children and life got a little bit harder and more complicated for sure. I once met a man in the jetway of an airplane. He was a brain surgeon, and he was asking me about the responsibility of flying an airplane. He said that at any point in time, he had a human being's life in his hands, but it was just one person at a time, and that he thought it was interesting to be a pilot because you had so many lives in your hands. And he asked me, you know, if I was ever worried about it. And I said, I leave the worry up to Jesus. He says, you're a smart guy, because he's worked on a lot of brains in his life, but he's never worked on a mind. He's seen a lot of brains in his life, but he's never seen somebody's mind. Well, Grandma Ray started to lose her memories and even forget the names of the food that she liked to eat. She never lost the spirit. And as her body started to dwindle, the spirit was still there. There's no one that I know in my life, of all the people I've ever met, that I'm more assured had the Holy Spirit with her. So I'm deeply comforted today to know that when she walked across that threshold to meet Jesus, he opened up his arms and said, well done, good and faithful servant. Well done.
You're coming up. I'll just hang here then.
Director of Hope Counseling, I forgot to say, she sent us this one thing. She says, I look forward to seeing Ray in heaven and hearing her say, welcome home, dear one. So she would say, she'd call everybody dear one. I hadn't thought about that for a while. Dear one, welcome home, dear one.
I hope that you're affected. I hope that you're emotionally affected. I hope that you're provoked in your heart, in your head. I hope it provokes and affects all of us. I think God gave her as a gift for that reason, to affect us, to provoke us, to want us to be like Ray, because Ray is like Jesus. And I think that's a good thing. And maybe you're thinking, I'm not like Ray, because I know I'm not like Ray. I want to be like Ray. But here's the thing, we can be like Ray because we have the same Savior as Ray. If you do not know the Savior, you can have the same Savior. You can have the same hope as Ray and let her life, the fruit of her life, bear fruit and continue to bear fruit in letting it encourage you to place your hope in the place that she had hope. And then truly her life will be effective, that helping others for the purpose of eternity. How fitting is it that we would close with that thought, that she wants to help everybody here for the purpose of eternity? And I know if she could speak today, she would do that and say that you can be like her because you have a Savior like her and you can have the same hope as her. If Sarah and Hans and Joe, go ahead and come up in a moment. While they're going up, we're going to show a video of Ray singing. Just a few short video clips as they're going up there. And then as soon as those video clips of Ray singing are done, we're all going to stand together and then we'll close with singing In Christ Alone. The reason why is because really that is her hope is that in Christ alone, she was able to be the woman she was because of Christ alone. She is a saint in the sense that we all who put our faith in Jesus are saints, but she wasn't a saint. She wasn't perfect, but she had a perfect one that she trusted in. And that is all of our hope that we share in Christ alone. Let that be our declaration, our way of honoring her memory, to say that our hope as well, we will put it in Christ alone. So let's see the videos and then we'll sing together.
How great thou art, how great thou art, thank thee, my God, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you, Jesus.
This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
And obey, for there's no other way to be happy in
Jesus
than to
be
trust
and obey.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Christ be with me, Christ within me, Christ behind me, Christ before me, Christ beside me, Christ to win me, Christ to comfort and restore me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ in quiet, Christ in danger, Christ in hearts of all that love me, Christ in mouth of friend and stranger. I bind unto myself the name, the strong name of the Trinity, by invocation of the same, the three in one and one in three, by whom all nature hath creation, eternal Father, Spirit, Word. Praise to the Lord of my salvation. Salvation is of Christ the Lord.
Christ alone, my hope is.
want to close with 1 Thessalonians 4:13. It says, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, with a trumpet shout, and the call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive remain on the earth. Will be caught up into the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever, so encourage each other with these words." I love that in the chronology that you have that Ray wrote for Messiah Academy, she wrote at the end, she wrote, "I praise him for what he has done and will continue to do until we see him face to face." She doesn't have to wait anymore. Now she's praising God face to face. Her hope is realized. Now we place our hope in the same Savior to sustain and comfort in the midst of loss, in the midst of mourning, in the midst of missing her, to comfort and bring the hope that she has. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the wonderful gift and the wonderful example that Ray was to each and every one of us of a life transformed by the grace of our Lord Jesus. All of our lives are like a vapor. None of us knows how long we have to live. And God, I pray that we might live the rest of our lives for you as Ray sought to. God, thank you for giving us all cause to hope in you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Would we all place fresh hope and faith in you, Jesus? Would you give us your joy, your peace, your comfort in the midst of sorrow? In your mighty name we hope, in your mighty name we pray, Jesus, amen. I want to go ahead and ask the family to go ahead and stand and go back to the multipurpose room back there. We'll go ahead and let them head out. We're going to release everyone in just a moment. As they're making their way back, one more sweet thing to know about Ray is that she was known as the strawberry grandma. And she was always giving out strawberries to the grandkids who would come to her house. And so the one thing we wanted to do as a way to remember her, and she's like a strawberry. She's so sweet and a special treat to our lives. And therefore, we want to invite you to a brief reception and a time of honoring Ray. And if you have stories about her, ways that she affected you, we want you to share that with the family as well. And there'll be a receiving line that you can talk to the family and honor them as well. So with that, we want to dismiss all of you to a time to share in a reception of honoring Ray. Thank you very much for being here. May the Lord be with you. You're dismissed.